Hey guys, BBI here. I want to stop and say thanks for tuning in and checking out whatever the video is about that's about ready to come up next. If you could take a minute and hit subscribe, I'd greatly appreciate it. And if you enjoy what you've seen here, make sure to hit the like button. We'd greatly appreciate your support. Anyhow, guys, all that aside, let's get on with the show. YouTube videos processing. I am I have been on overload now going on a couple weeks. I'm just getting my feet back on the ground after having to manage my boss's tow business for a couple weeks. I keep getting texts from people, dude, you okay? Did you die? Yes, I'm fine. Just super busy. Look at this. Ugh. Brand new 3000. Brand new 3000. This was owned by my business partner. And the family sent it up here with me to get rid of it. Well, I got a guy who wants to buy it with an amplifier built around it, and I think I'm gonna do just that. He's a good dude. There ain't no bullshit with him. I'm just sitting here waiting on the check. But that's not what we're here to talk about today. We're here to talk about this. This is an Eagle made 4cx800. That's it. And we're going to tear it apart. We're going to go through it. We're going to check everything. And we're going to add a manual key to it. We want to check the relays in it. And then I want to go through the power supply. And we're going to load it up. And we're going to sell it. It's got to go to a new home. So when you get this, whoever ends up buying this, it's going to come to you in three pieces. Power supply, amp deck, and tube. In three pieces. So here's the exact tube that was in it. This is the one that went bad. I don't know why he sent this to me, because this thing is roached. This tube here. He sent this to me about a month before he passed. He says, test it. And I'm like, I can't. What do you mean you can't? I'm like, I don't have an amp to run it in. I can high pot test it. Which it holds volts, it just doesn't build no power. The Russian Federation has dropped, I don't know, 80,000 of these on the market in the last year, which these were incredibly expensive for a hot minute. But with them offloading so much equipment into the American market share through eBay, this tube is in stupid cheap. I mean, stupid cheap. They make a ton of power for what they are, by the way. A ton of peak power. I mean, just a ton of peak power for what they are. So, this big deck for that little guy. Let's pull the lid. Let's look inside. Two-piece unit. Guess what this two-piece unit's got? Oh, voltmeter. Yay, voltmeter. You guys are going to be crying in a minute. That's it. That's everything in here. Because that's all it takes. Blocker, load, doctor coil, load, output. Match to antenna, match to tube. Resonant for freak. Legit mag wire. Big anode cap dissipator, which is an upgrade. My friend Frank put that on there. This is this little black glob of stuff here is the knockdown resistors that drives this meter. It's got a dual line section installed on it. Dual line section and a way oversized blower. If I'm not mistaken, you could probably use the same blower to cool a couple of these 800s. Power supply uses a separate 110 volt plug, and this is your input network right here. Input coax, output coax. Very basic. Relays on the bottom. Let's look at that. Pretty basic. We upgraded the relay when I was down there about a month and a half ago. Went to this 35 amper, which is necessary. Input from coax, or input from tube, output to coax connector in the back. So our input inductor coil. Pretty basic. RF comes in, goes through this inductor coil, shunt load to ground, back through a blocking capacitor, down through an inductor for isolation, voltage isolation issues. And then this is our bias circuit here. And that is our 12 volt supply to run our relays and so on, whatnot. And our lamps in the front. Pretty basic. I could not believe when I went down how within a couple weeks, everything had cobwebs all over it. It just amazed me how fast the spiders moved into that situation. It really did. Well, we're gonna hook ourselves up a key-in circuit, which I wired him a temporary one here, which was hooked to this connector, which was hooked to another keyer box. It worked for him, but for this to work in the real world, I need to put an RCA connector on the back of this thing. So we'll probably end up drilling a hole somewhere in this space and hooking this wire up to it. Key-in circuit's really important. It's currently set up for an auto key, but you have the tendency to really blow off the contacts on the relay pretty quick by having that auto key circuit, because it, for a nanometer, it's got to break the connection from here to here, and that causes an arc. Shink. This is going from here to here. It causes an arc. Shink, because there's no place for the RF to go. So you get a high SWR spike, and then on the output side, zap, as it's loading up, because the tube's already turning on and making power, there's no place for the output RF to go. So it ends up scuffing up the contacts on the relay pretty quick. So the best way to get around that and maintain the longest longevity out of your connections in a relay is manual key. So I gotta run and go get a different plug for the 220 side of this thing on the power supply here in a minute. And yeah, I gotta hunt me down RCA cable or RCA jack. Which I could have swore I had a bunch of those, but for the life of me, I can't find them right at this second. So maybe we can go find one at the STOA. I shall return. Okay. So now we got our foot pedal installed, which is this gold-plated RCA jack. Got it run over here to this trigger relay. So now we got to look at what we've got going on for our input pass-through SWR. So RF come in, goes through the myriad of shit here, and goes out to the coax connector and goes over to the dummy load. Well, as it sits right now, it ain't very good. Let's zoom on in here and see if it focuses. Right where the red cross needle's at, the little arrow, we have an SWR of 1.9. Now, in all fairness, we have to change some things here. We will take the lid of the cabinet, the base lid, and we will put this on the deck. And just the proximity of the cabinet will change the capacitance value, but it won't change it very much. 1.89. Lid open, 1.89. Okay. Well, I have a feeling that I'm gonna need one of these capacitors and one of these capacitors. Yep, it's gonna get it pretty close. So if I take two of these capacitors and I hook them together. Now, one of the biggest pet peeves that he had was it seemed like he could never hear through the box. Well, if you got an SWR going two going through the cabinet, I've overshot it. Okay. What's the little digi say? If you got an SWR2 going through the cabinet, you're basically mousing your ears by a lot. So let's try this. It helps a little bit. You're making yourself deaf by not compensating for this. Deaf. You're making yourself deaf. All right. That's better. Take a 1.3 over a 1.9. It's about 40. Oh, so what happens if I put 100 on it? What's that get us? Nope, overshot it. Which is 1.4, so 50. What's 75 get us? We'll get here. 1.4. So it's 50 to 60 puff. Get us a 1.39. Always make sure to test it with the lid in place. I'd like to get that lower. Okay. Give me a minute to twiddly fart. We'll get this figured out. Okay, so the blue line represents what we had going on before. The yellow line represents what we have now. I'll take a 1.28 versus a 2 any day of the week. So that means you're actually going to hear through this thing pretty reliably. So that makes me happy. Let's zoom on out here a little bit. So now the next step of this, let's put the lid on it, and that'll drop us to 1.8. I'll take it and smile. The next step is we're gonna partially assemble this thing. And I gotta wheel over the power supply. And we'll go through the power supply top to bottom, or as the Marines like to put it, tip to butt. And we'll verify everything is working perfectly. We're gonna let this thing run for a little bit, because it has been sitting for the last couple weeks. Hasn't been touched. And I want to give the tube the opportunity to normalize out. Here we go, Scroob. Thanks, Scroob. Appreciate you playing along, Scrooby. Okay. Power this up when we get back. Well, we're gonna go through the RF deck, then we'll power, or the power supply, and then we'll power it up. Well, this is simplicity at its best. It would have never occurred to me to do something like this, have a separate power plug to power the head unit, and then a separate plug to power the power supply. That's assuming a lot with somebody's electrical system, but get it. All you gotta do is tie on your grounds, hook up your high voltage lead, hook up your antenna, hook up your radio, and turn it on, let the filament run for a couple minutes. And filament and blower, of course, which once again, I can't believe they're separated, but they are. But yeah, and there's no time off timer, none of that. So it's a very basic, straightforward box, but it makes a lot of power. So well, it is what it is. I mean, if it was me, I would have another power plug here, but simplicity at its finest. Okay, let's flip it around. Let's put power on it. Let's get it running. That's where we're going to sit for about the next 2 hours. I want to give the tube an opportunity to normalize in its environment. So we're not going to just rush in and start slamming shit on here. Like, this controls your bias. This is your OPT and standby for your auto key. Now it's a manual key, but the switch down here doesn't have a label on it, which I gotta put a label on it to make it minimum safe. There's no fuses on this, by the way, either. Unbelievable. There are no fuses on this at all. it's your high voltage switch. Okay. So for right now, we want the tube to come up in temp, and we want to sit here and idle for a little bit. It is a Russian tube, but in the same breath, it has been over a month since this tube has seen any action. So we're gonna give it a few. Instead of me standing here wasting more of your guys' precious moments in your lives, I'm gonna go inside and I'll be back out here in a little bit. Okay, so over here on this meter, we have hooked up to the dual burn line section on the back of the box, a 5,000 watt slug. This has also got a multiplier on it. It's the same peak kit that's in this meter. Then we have a 100 watt slug in reverse here. We have a 1,000 watt slug independent in peak, 1,000 in average, and a 5 watt slug in reverse. We're going to put this one in the corner, that one in the corner. We're not going to come close to putting that one in the corner. Okay, so let's talk about a couple things. When I go and unload this out, I find that my tuning points are completely different than his. Antenna is different. We're going into a dummy load here. Drive's different. There's a lot of different things here in this situation. We're gonna flick this into standby. And we're gonna go over here and we're gonna look at this 1,000 watt in peak. At 0.12. This is an incredibly low drive box, you guys. Incredibly low drive. Do not call me up and say, hey, I wanna buy this amp. Can you make it run with a 955? My answer will be no, and I'll hang the phone up on you. I don't have time for craziness on this deal. Here, let's set this up here so it's not completely out of the way for everything, or in the way for everything. So we're gonna run this thing on low. So we'll flip the operate switch on. We're gonna step on the foot pedal. Ta-da. Over 1,000 watts on low. Ta-da. We're showing about 1,500 here. Take the multiplier and we'll turn it to 2x. We'll see if that data flies. Ta-da. About 16 or so on that meter. So now let's make them read the same. Flip that down to 5x. Now that 1,000 watt slug is reading like a 5,000 watt slug. Everything's pretty much the same. So now what we're going to do is we're going to flip this over to high. Everybody got that? Let's do it again. Over 1,000 average, and that's from the plain Jane non-flash bench radio, the 2950, which is around there. And of course the input tune, I haven't even looked at that yet. At 011, look at this. Hello, 1111. Pretty good. I haven't even adjusted it. I could probably get back there and make it even lower, but it's not worth it. We're seeing about 3,500 watts peak on the knockoff Chinesium Watts Electronics meters. Seeing about 3,500 peak here and well over 1,000 average. So we'll grab the 5,000 watt slug, pull this 1,000 out. That's a 5,000 watt slug. Nope, I pulled that out of the 100 watt hole. Damn, Luke, come on, pay attention. Let's try this again. Hello. About 1,500 bird, 1,300 bird. So those numbers all track. I'm impressed. I mean, it's working. Let's see how fast some bleeders work. Yeah. Yeah. There's no fancy time off timers or nothing on this, so your fingers are what control what happens here. We'll shut the filament down and we'll let it cool off for a minute. I like this little box, it's cute. It's really cute. Well, take three on this little bit. Let's see if we can get through it without the phone ringing. We're coming down to the tail end of things here. We got four or five more boxes left for him to sell and a whole bunch of the little small stuff like bird meters and peat kits and that kind of thing. But this particular package I want to sell as a whole. Amp and meters. These are brand new bird elements, legit bird elements. That's a 5,000 watt slug. This has got a peat kit in it. You know, if we were to part this out as pieces, each one of the meter movements is about 30 bucks a piece because they're the Watts Electronics meter movements, but they read right on the money as we've seen. The peat kit's about 50 something dollars. The cabinet and the wire leads is about another 35 bucks. And each one of the elements is about 150. We're gonna sell this for 300 on top of this. So I want 2,300 for this. So $2,600 total plus the ride. No, I'm not interested in breaking these up. I want to sell this as a complete plug and play zero to a hero station. And it's worth every penny. Every penny. The thing makes 3,500 watts peak with 30 watts of drive, which is just amazing to me. And it makes about 1,500 watts bird with a plain Jane radio hitting it. I was going to hook a D-Row radio up to it and see what it did, but nah, this thing's just going to work just fine. Went ahead and we put some labels on the front. I am going to put some BBI stickers on the back. I did not do anything to these boxes, you guys. I literally blew the cobwebs out of them. Made sure everything worked. The meters and everything all works. That's it. So I can't take any claim of having my name in here as any kind of rebuild or anything. This is literally the way I received it. Everything works great. You'll receive the package in, well, you'll receive your package in four parts. The meters will come on their own little package. Power supply is going to come in a crate, amp deck is going to come in a crate, and the tube is going to come separately. So all you got to do is drop the tube in, turn on, burn the filament with blower here for a hot minute, you know, probably 30 minutes after you first get it. Then flip on the operate switch and turn on a high voltage switch and load it out. It just sells itself, you know what I mean? It is what it is. $2,600 plus the ride gets you a plug-and-play station on a big box side, up to about 3,500 watts. So, first one to call me with a valid form of payment gets it, 208-392-0108. The number's a little bit covered up back there, but shoot me a text or give me a ring on the old telly, and we'll get it headed out the door to you. Well, gentlemen, I got about 7 million other things I got to go do today. As always, never stops over here, never stops. I'm going to jet out of here and I'm going to go work on them and get these wheeled up into the shipping department and get ready to send them out of here. So on that note, I thank every single one of you guys. I appreciate you for tuning in and following along. On to the next bit in the show.